In this problem, we have four functions, four real functions, the uniform distribution, the binomial distribution, the geometric, and also the Poisson distribution. And the purpose of this problem is to show that they are probability distributions. And what that really means is just two things. These functions are non-negative. That's easy, really easy to check just by looking at them. And also that when you add up all the function values over the real numbers from minus infinity to infinity, you get one. So that's all we have to do in these four cases. So that's super simple. There are some interpretations of these distributions that we can talk about later, but let's first look at what we have to do here. So let's begin with the uniform distribution, which is really simple. It's just the function, well, it's zero everywhere except in n points, 1, 2, 3 up to n, where it's got the constant value 1 over n. So let's look at that. So we have pk, we have to check the first thing. Well, pk is either 0 or 1 over n, so it's obviously non-negative. That's super easy. You can't really write much more in an explanation than that, so that's fine to write. The second thing here, when we take the sum over these pk's, well, it's basically just a whole lot of zeros that we're adding together, except for these terms here, 1 over n, and we've got k going from 1 to n for those. And here we're just ignoring all the other infinitely many terms where we've got 0 there. And this is just equal to, well, in each of these k values, we've got 1 over n as the function value. So we have, we have n terms, each of which is equal to 1 over n. So this is equal to 1, and that's exactly what we want. We've now verified these two conditions. So apparently this function here, this uniform distribution, is indeed a probability distribution, and we're done with that. That's all you need to do. So for the binomial distribution, we do the same thing. So let's see. Here we go. First of all, you look at the function and you see, okay, here's a binomial coefficient that's non-negative. Here, we have to figure out what this p is. P is some value, a probability between 0 and 1. They're strictly greater than 0, less than 1. So any power of p is also going to be non-negative. Great. 1 minus p also lies between 0 and 1, so that's non-negative, and so is any power of it. So we just have a product of non-negative things, that's non-negative. So again, we have that this function here, this binomial distribution function, is now also non-negative. So we've checked the first thing. And again, it's really hard to write anything because it's pretty obvious. So just write this and you're fine. For the second part, that's a bit more interesting. Here we have to add up all of these terms. So we're adding up over pk again, over all the terms. And if we only focus on the terms that are actually positive, not zero, then we're looking at these terms here, 0, 1, up to n. So k goes from 0 up to n. And let's see what these terms are. Actually, this is sort of a big term, so let's write it down here. K goes from 0 to, and that's supposed to be an n. And here we have binomial term k choose n times p to the power of k times 1 minus p to the power of n minus k. It's a bit of a mouthful, but if you look at it, you recognize, hey, that's actually just the binomial expression that you see in the binomial theorem. So if we use the binomial theorem, we see, well, here we've got something, we've got p, and we've got 1 minus p, and if you then use the binomial theorem, let's just write bt, be a little lazy here, then we've got that's equal to p plus 1 minus p to the power of n. So these two add up to give 1, these cancel, the p's here cancel, we have 1 to the power of n, which is 1. And again, we have that this condition is satisfied, so this function here is in fact a probability distribution, and we're halfway done. Now we only have to do the other two, the geometric and the Poisson distribution, in exactly the same way. So this is easy stuff. So let's go on to the geometric probability. Oh, sorry, the distribution. Okay. So, again, we look at the function here. It's either zero or something else, and the something else, again, depends on this p here, which, just like in the binomial distribution, is a probability between 0 and 1. So this is non-negative, 1 minus p is also non-negative, and so is any power. So again, all of this is non-negative. And we can quickly say, well, this is, the first condition is true. So what about the sum of all of these? Well, let's look at that. So here we have pk, and, whoops, and out of all the infinitely many k's that we have to sum over here, only these give something non-zero. So which are those? They are where k is 1, 2, 3, and so forth. So we've got infinitely many of them, but only discretely many. So we can sum over these, hopefully. Let's see whether we can. So k goes from 1 to infinity here. And, well, what's pk in this case? It's equal to this expression there. So p times 1 minus p to the power of k. And again, just like in the binomial case, we have something that looks a bit scary, but we have a shortcut to figure out what it is. In fact, this is just a geometric sum. So in particular, it's equal to, well, if we take p outside the sum here, and here I'm actually forgetting one index, sorry. And let's write it up again, and 1 minus p. Now, if we shift the index, so instead of having k minus 1, so when k is equal to 1, that would be 0. Then we could just start in 0 and instead write k. So we have the same numbers up here. So here we have when k is 1, then we've got 0. When k is 2, then we've got 1. Down here we've got when k is 0, we've got 0. So it's the same numbers that we've got. We're just shifting the index. And we do that because this sum here is in fact just equal to 1 over 1 minus 1 minus p, it's a bit of a mouthful, so 1 minus 1 minus p, and of course then that cancels out and gives you p times 1 over p, which is 1, and we're happy because that's exactly what we wanted. So we've shown that the geometric distribution is in fact a probability distribution, and that only leaves us the very last distribution to look at, so let's do that. So, this board is getting messier and messier as we go along. Okay, cool. So for this distribution, we have something that looks a bit weirder, but it turns out not to be any harder than the binomial or the geometric distributions. First of all, we look at the first condition. Is this non-negative? Well, certainly zero is not negative. What about these terms here? Well, you've got an exponential function. They're never negative. You've got some lambda. And we've got to figure out what the lambda is now. Lambda is any positive parameter. It can be really big, but it can't be negative. So these powers here are non-negative. And we're dividing by k factorial, where k is any of these numbers, 0, 1, etc. So these numbers will always be 1 or greater. In other words, all of this is again non-negative, and we can confidently state this, and we're done. The second part, the second and last part of this, is to add these together. Okay, and we've got pk again. We have to figure out what k's we're talking about. So here we've got k being equal to 0, 1, 2, etc. In fact, infinitely many terms. And let's see what that's equal to. So pk was the exponential function e to the power of minus lambda, lambda to the power of k divided by k factorial, where k goes from 0 to infinity. And again, just like in the previous two cases, this looks scary and difficult, but it's not. We have a simple formula to cut this down to a simple answer. And the way that we can do that is take e to the power of minus lambda outside of the sum. And then we just have lambda to the power of k divided by k factorial, which is in fact just the the expansion of e to the power of lambda, the exponential function. So you can talk about the Maclaurin series or Fourier series, or maybe you've seen this before, but whichever the case is, we get that this is equal to e to the power of lambda, and then if you multiply that by e to the power of minus lambda, you get 1, and we are done. So we've shown that these four functions are in fact probability distributions, but probability distributions of what? Well, if we have a random variable, let's call it x, then each of the probabilities here could express the probability that x was equal to whichever k we've got, the k here and in the functions. So in the uniform case, we'd write x is distributed uniformly with parameter n, or in the binomial case, we'd write x is distributed, that little squiggle or tilde says distributed, binomially with parameters n and p. And finally, we've got the geometric and Poisson distributions. If x has this probability distribution, then we say that it's geometrically distributed with parameters just p now, just one parameter. And finally, we have if x is distributed, is distributed in this way, with a Poisson distribution, then we write it like this. You don't have to worry too much about this notation, but you see it in the course notes, and this is exactly what we mean when you see this sort of notation. So what does the notation actually symbolize, or what interpretation is there of each of these four distributions? Well, for instance, in the uniform distribution, it could be that something happens with the same probability. If you're rolling a die and you might get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6, the probability of getting each of those is the same. It's 1 over 6. So that would be uniformly distributed with parameter 6. If x is distributed binomially, well, an interpretation would be that we're rolling a die n times, and then we're counting how many sixes do we get, for instance. Then p would be 1 over 6, that's the chance of getting a 6. In the geometric case here, where x is geometrically distributed, it's very similar. We're rolling a die again and again, and we're asking, well, how many times does it take? So x is the number of times that we have to roll the dice until we get something like, for instance, a 6. So that's the geometric distribution, where we're waiting for something. The Poisson distribution is sort of the opposite. Turns it on its head and says, well, we know on average how long we have to wait, but given that, within some time frame, how many things actually occur? How many times do we actually roll a 6, given that we know that we get a 6 so often? So these probability distributions have some very normal, everyday interpretations that we actually see all the time. So thank you very much.